On behalf of the principal, management, and faculty of the department, I extend my warm welcome to all our present here. The Department of Commerce is one of the pioneering departments in the college, celebrated its golden jubilee in the presence of His Excellency Sri Banwarilal Purohit during the year 2018-19. The department had produced around 450 MPhils, 85 PhDs under the able guidance and supervision of 12 research guides. At present, 21 students are doing their PhD and 8 MPhil full-time scholars are pursuing their course of study. Currently, the second year PG students and MPhil students are in the process of preparing their project and dissertation. In order to cater to the project preparation needs of the students, the department is planning to organize a webinar of this kind. Virtual learning has become the order of the day. Academic connect and periodical updation is one of the mission goals of the department. Based on the request from the MPhil students, research scholars and other students, research in commerce and social science has been chosen as the first episode in this webinar series. To start this teaching and learning initiative, our head of the department, Dr. J. Jayashankar, has kindly consulted to orient the students on the topic research in commerce and social sciences. I am sure the entire audience are enthused to listen to his lecture. Though the resource person for the day, Dr. Jayashankar sir, is known to all of us by face and through his textbooks, I take pleasure in introducing him formally. Dr. J. Jayashankar is an associate professor and head the Department of Commerce, D.G. Vaishnav College, and he has around 3 decades of service and he is senior most faculty in the college. He is currently guiding 6 PhD scholars and 1 PhD scholar has already submitted her thesis and is awaiting Vaibhavos examination. Dr. Jayashankar has guided 23 MPhil scholars so far. He has authored 9 books and most of his books are recommended by University of Madras and other universities in the South for their BCom, MCom, MBA and other commerce related courses. He has also published around 15 research articles in journals. The University of Madras has appointed him as a convener and member of affiliating committees to recommend the grant of affiliation to degree courses, and he has conducted inspection in more than 10 colleges in and around Chennai. He is also a member of Board of Studies at Ethiraj College, Guru Nanak College, Vivekananda College and SRM University. He has conducted academic audit in many city colleges. Sir has a YouTube channel in his name and has made more than 10 e-content videos until now, covering a wide range of topics in commerce. Sir, you are a true sense of inspiration for all of us. Thank you for being a man of discipline, commitment to profession and professional content. Sir, you are setting the right direction for every one of us to learn and to carry out our job in the right manner, sir. Sir, with this introduction, I request you to take over the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sunduri, for your wonderful introduction. Good morning, everyone. This is Dr. Jayashankar, head of the Department of Commerce, D.G. Vaishnav College. Our department is organizing a webinar series starting from today. Today's episode, of course, will focus on research in commerce and social sciences. Social science will deal with human relationships. Economics is a social science. It studies human wants and satisfaction. Sociology, of course, is a social science. It studies group behavior. Psychology studies human mind. And what about our subject, commerce? Commerce is a branch of business. Business has got 3 branches: industry, trade, and commerce. And what is the role of commerce? It will remove all hindrances in the market, hindrances of exchange, hindrances of persons, place, time, risks and uncertainties. So we have banking, insurance, transportation, warehouse and middlemen who perform the functions of commerce. We cannot imagine these functions being done without the participation of a human element. So commerce can also be included under the category of social science. Now I am going to discuss with you today what are all the peculiar problems a researcher in commerce and social sciences will face. We'll start our presentation now. Hope you are able to see the PPT. Sundari ma'am, is it visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Your screen is visible, sir.
Very good. Now, a researcher doing research in commerce and other social sciences will come across certain peculiar problems which are not to be there in the case of research in physical sciences such as chemistry or physics. What are these peculiar problems? Subjective concepts, but objective analysis is required. Most of the problems that are being researched in commerce are subjective in nature. For example, job satisfaction, brand preference, employee stress, all these are qualitative concepts. You can quantify sales. Sales can be expressed in numerical terms. It can be expressed in terms of number of units. But how do you express job satisfaction in numerical terms? How do you explain brand preference in numerical terms? It is not possible because the concept itself is subjective, qualitative. So the first task before the researcher is to collect data which will be in subjective form, but subjective analysis is not accepted in research. You cannot do analysis subjectively. Quantitative analysis, that is statistical analysis, is what is required. So how does the researcher go about doing qualitative, that is using the qualitative data for statistical analysis? Researchers have developed what are called scaling techniques. Most of you are familiar with Likert's 5-point scale. It will give 5 options to the respondents in giving out their responses. So in the questionnaire, there are several statements and the researcher gives 5 options to the respondents, starting from strongly agree to strongly disagree. Later, what does the researcher do? He will assign values to each of the statements, starting from 1 to 5, depending upon the response he has received. So based on whether the respondent agrees with a particular statement or shows disagreement, values are assigned. Then the researcher will compute the total score of each and every respondent. This he will do for all the questionnaires that he has given for data collection. Now, the researcher has managed to convert the qualitative data into quantitative form. Now it will be possible for him to carry out any kind of statistical analysis. It is possible to do correlation, chi-square, and use any kind of statistical tool. So the first and the foremost problem for the researcher is that the data is in qualitative form and he has to translate it, transform it, convert it into numerical form. That is one peculiar problem that he faces. This problem is not faced by those who do research in natural sciences, because there whatever is being researched is quantifiable and measurable in numerical terms. Secondly, any problem that is taken up for research in commerce and social sciences is influenced by numerous variables. Let us take the case of job satisfaction. Job satisfaction is not the outcome of any particular variable. You can't say salary alone decides job satisfaction, or the kind of rapport you maintain with the management, that alone doesn't decide or determine job satisfaction. The work environment, the facilities available for the employees. So when you take job satisfaction into account, it is the outcome of so many influencing variables. Now the question here arises is, will it be possible for the researcher studying job satisfaction to consider all those numerous variables in his study? Definitely it is not going to be possible for him. Possible for any researcher to study a research problem by considering all the influencing variables. Then how will the researcher go about his research work? You all have heard of what is called literature review. Review of literature, we say. So there have already been research studies done earlier on the subject of job satisfaction. So what our researcher will do is, he will review literature of research studies on job satisfaction done over a period of, let us say, 5 years. What is it that the other researchers, the earlier researchers, have done on job satisfaction? As he goes through each and every research work thesis, he will try to understand what are all the factors, variables that the earlier researchers have included in their studies. So he comes to a conclusion that he has to focus on certain variables which have not been considered earlier by the other researchers. In other words, he has to identify, when he reviews literature, he has to identify what is called the research gap. So his study will fill the research gap. That is how research in social sciences will be done. So it is not possible for any researcher to analyze a problem, to carry out research of a problem by taking into account all the influencing variables. So literature review is required, identifying the research gap is very much essential, and our researcher will focus attention on variables not considered by the earlier studies. But the impact of all the variables on the problem is not ruled out. Although you focus attention, supposing, let us say that our researcher studies job satisfaction with reference to interpersonal relationships, with reference to the tangible benefits that are provided to employees and few other factors, that doesn't mean other factors have no influence on job satisfaction. This in fact becomes a limitation of the study itself. So the researcher, in the thesis, the researcher mentions some of the limitations of his study. Invariably, every researcher will state that he has done his study by considering certain variables only, as all the variables cannot be included for the study. Hope this is clear to you all. Then the third peculiar problem the researcher faces is that he has to be satisfied with the sample study only. You cannot consider all the population units. There is no time. For example, if some researcher wants to study job stress of employees working in IT firms in Chennai, let us assume there are 2 lakh employees working in the various IT firms in Chennai. Will it be possible for the researcher to interview all the 2 lakh employees? Will it be possible for him to give the questionnaire to all the 2 lakh employees, collect data from them, analyze it? Definitely, it's not going to be possible. So he will have what is called a sample size. So he will have 500 or 1,000 as his sample size. He will prepare the questionnaire and give it to 500 or 1,000 employees in various IT firms, collect data, do the analysis, and he will try to attribute the results of his study to the entire population. He will say, this is how the problem is faced by the employees working in the various IT firms. So the conclusion drawn based on sample study is attributed to the entire population. There is nothing wrong in it, but the extent to which the results will be accurate, that's not guaranteed. That depends much on how exactly he has picked up his sample, and also it depends on whether the sample he has selected is representative of the population. Actually, when you have a population of 2 lakhs, a sample of 500 is not adequate at all. So the sample size has to be large. The rule is, the larger the sample size, the greater the accuracy of the findings of the researcher. So you can have even up to 10,000 as your sample size. Only then you can hope to have a certain amount of accuracy or precision in your findings. Otherwise, accuracy is not guaranteed. But for the sake of time and other constraints that we experience, when we do our research, limit the sample size to 500. Very rarely we come across a sample size of 1,000. And what is more important than the size of the sample is the representative nature of the sample. That is, when you are studying the problem of job stress of employees of IT firms, we all know that there are some IT firms which have a high brand value. So when we mention IT firms, the names that come to our mind immediately are the names of Infosys, TCS, Wipro, HCL, etc. What if the researcher carries out his research on job stress, ignoring these firms? Now, why does he ignore these firms? He has not been given permission to enter the firm and collect data. So what does the researcher do? He has taken the decision to study job stress of employees in IT firms, but prominent companies such as TCS, HCL, Wipro have not given him permission to do data collection work. They don't want the researcher to get information, any information about the company or about its employees. So permission has been denied. So our researcher settles for few companies which are not so popular. In other words, these companies that he has considered are not representative of the IT industry at all. So when your sample doesn't represent the population, then obviously the results that you are going to arrive at will not have any reliability at all about the problem of job stress in IT firms. In fact, I have attended a number of PhD YOS examinations and also raised questions. I myself have been an external examiner for PhD YOS examinations. Invariably, most of the research scholars would say when they do their presentation that they have gone in for convenient sampling. Convenient sampling, remember, is not acceptable. It will not give you proper results. You choose the sample based on your convenience, not because the sample represents the universe. Why your convenience? Because you have been denied access by reputed firms. So you choose a company where you are given permission to do data collection. How do you expect the result to be reliable? Because the firm itself is an unknown firm and it doesn't represent the industry. Hope the point that I'm trying to tell you is very clear and you have understood it. So when you talk of sample study is the only way out, population study is not at all possible in social science. But in the case of natural science, it is not like that. For example, a small quantity of blood is enough to check whether a person is a diabetic or whether he has cholesterol, bad cholesterol, beyond the permissible level. So what is true of the sample blood is also true of the population. What is done at micro level holds good at macro level also. That is what is the truth insofar as natural science is concerned. But in the case of social science, what is true at the micro level, it may not be true, but we try to give the impression that that's what exists at the macro level also. That's what is the situation at the population level. But to say that, you must be able to justify that your sample size is adequate and the sample is also representative of the universe. It's not something that's unknown, not so important. The sample selected must be of significance. That is important. Then, next point is the influence of the time factor. See, in natural science, what has been evolved today out of the research will remain true, will hold good forever. H2 plus O will give water, always. But in the case of social science research, what has been evolved today by the researcher may remain valid for a brief period of time. It may be valid for 3 years or maximum of 5 years. Afterwards, it will lose its validity. I can give you any number of examples to prove this point. See, there was a time when we all hailed public sector banks. Banks were nationalized in India in the year 1969, and many hailed the decision of the government. But today, we all feel that private sector and foreign banks perform better than the so-called public sector banks. The quality of service rendered by private sector and global banks is much better than that of the public sector banks. Likewise, a few years back, we were buying all the durables we wanted, like refrigerators, washing machines, etc., etc., only from dealers. But what is the trend today? We don't go to any dealer to buy a TV or a refrigerator or a washing machine. We prefer buying it online. So the retailers have started losing their significance. If you see the market trend now the retailers don't have very many customers, because most of us prefer to buy online through online firms like Amazon or Flipkart. And of course, they also give you a lot of benefits in the form of huge discounts, and they give you so many payment options. They provide even installment facility. They give you cash upon delivery facility. You can pay through internet banking, door delivery is given, and if the piece is found to be defective, you can even return it. So all these benefits are under. What about product review? They even give product review. When you are considering so many models of TV and refrigerator, so you will know about each model, each brand. Product review is also available on the Amazon website. So you can compare model X with model Y. So everything is possible, and you have the convenience of buying from home. You need not waste your time going to different dealers to see various brands, make a comparison of brands. It's not necessary at all. So the market trends have changed. Better methods of buying have been evolved over the years. So what was once appreciated, hailed, is no longer appreciated. This has happened mainly because of the time factor. So economic conditions change, political conditions change, and market conditions also change due to the passage of time. And what was once appreciated is now criticized. So it is very clear that when you do some research work and come out with certain findings, you should remember that your findings are not going to hold good forever. Maybe it will remain valid, relevant for a brief period of time, maybe 2 years, 3 years. Afterwards, your study will become outdated. It will be considered as outdated. And a new study is required. But this problem is generally not faced by those who do research in social, in physical sciences, natural sciences. Hope you have understood this point. Then the next one is regional differences. Two atoms of hydrogen, one atom of oxygen produce water, no matter where the experiment is conducted. That is what I have stated. You are seeing it on your laptop screen. But what is true of work culture in India may not be true of the work culture elsewhere in the world. The attitude of workers in villages and that of the workers in cities and towns may not be the same. Same is true with respect to concepts like values, perception, personality, level of motivation, and so on. So in research in commerce and social sciences, what is true of Chennai may not be true of Bihar or West Bengal. The work culture of Chennai is different from the work culture of Bihar. So if some researcher attempts a study on work culture of employees of Chennai firms, and let us assume that a similar study is undertaken by another researcher in the state of Bihar, the results are not going to be the same. This exists mainly because of the regional differences. There are cultural differences, perceptual differences. There are differences in the value systems of individuals. What is true of India is not true of the rest of the world. We all know that in our workplaces, our workers always have grievances and complaints. So in order to express their complaints and grievances, what do our workers do? They resort to strike. They strike work. That is how they show their protest. But we all know, we have heard others saying that in the rest of the world, workers, in order to show their protest, they don't strike work, they work overtime. That is how they show their protest. Because the perception of the people here and the perception of the people, the perception of the employees living in other parts of the world is not the same. So you don't have a solution to a problem in social science that is universally relevant. So what is true of Chennai may not be true of Mumbai or other parts of India. And what is true of India may not be true of the rest of the world. This again is not so in the case of natural sciences, physics, chemistry, etc., etc. What is true here is true in other parts of the world. So a vaccine has been evolved for COVID-19, Covaxin and Covishield. These vaccines are globally used. They are known to everybody. But it is not so insofar as research in social science is concerned. Hope it's clear. Then the next point is influence of technology. Technology also plays a crucial role in influencing the findings of research studies in commerce and social sciences. We all have done conventional banking. So there was a time when a person who wanted to draw cash had to go to the bank during working hours on a working day, and he would fill in the withdrawal form or use the check to draw cash. This is what is conventional banking. But how many of us do transactions this way nowadays? We are all comfortable taking money from ATMs and paying through online mode or using our debit or credit cards. That is how banking transactions are done nowadays. This has happened because of the influence of technology. Even classes are being held by us online. Until last year, we were not quite familiar with the online mode of taking lessons. But now we feel we are much better taking online classes. For students and teachers, most of the faculty members also prefer online mode to offline mode. So, due to the influence of technology, what is considered desirable or suitable today may be found to be unsuitable after some time. I mentioned to you a little while ago about buying durable goods online. So there was a time when we were buying all the things that we wanted by going to a retail shop. But now we feel comfortable buying any product online, whether it is a mobile phone or a laptop or a wristwatch. We are comfortable buying it online. So there might have been research studies in the past that hailed the conventional banking service. But if a study on the traditional banking is done today, obviously the conclusion will be against the conventional mode of banking, which is still followed. It's not that we have only ATMs and digital payments. Conventional banking system still exists. So yeah, someone who is a lay person who is not familiar with the online mode of transactions will have to go to the bank, use the conventional withdrawal slip or the check, get the token from the clerk, wait at the cash counter, and then take the money from the cashier. that system still prevails, and it's not going to be appreciated if a research study is done on the conventional mode of work, particularly in a bank. The same is true with reference to insurance sector also. I still remember the days when, about 10 years back, 15 years back, when I bought a car or a two-wheeler and I needed insurance for the car or two-wheeler, I had to go to some insurance company, pay the premium, and he would give a receipt and tell me, we would post the policy, we would send it by registered post, and you will get it after a month. So we had to wait for months for getting our insurance policy. Now it's not like that. You can go to the website of any insurance company, just enter your vehicle number or your mobile number. So all the details you can see on the screen, computer screen. Then it will also show how much premium you have to pay for renewing your policy. You can pay that amount using your internet banking facility, and you give your email ID. The policy will be sent to you within 5 minutes. The policy document will be sent to your email ID. So you can have it in e-form. The policy you can have in your laptop, your hard drive, or you can get it transferred to your mobile phone also and keep it in your mobile phone, or you can even take a printout and have a hard copy of the insurance policy. So there is no need to go to any insurance office for getting an insurance policy. Everything is done online. So that is what is the benefit of technology. So obviously, when a research study is conducted on the conventional mode of work of our banking and insurance companies, and also the way we are doing it today, obviously that the findings of both the research studies will be different. Conventional mode of work is going to be criticized, and the technology driven mode of operation is going to be hailed and appreciated. Hope it's clear. Then there is lack of industry academia coordination. This is one of the most important criticisms made against any research study in commerce and social sciences. See what happens in our social science research. The researcher will do the research under the supervision of a guide. He will prepare the report thesis and submit it to the university. The report is sent for external evaluation, and it is evaluated, and a VIVA's examination will have to be conducted here. The research scholar faces the VIVA's examination, and he defends the thesis, and the degree is awarded to him, and that is the end of it. There is no follow-up of the research work actually done by the research scholar. So getting the degree is the ultimate goal of any academic research. It lacks practical application. Nobody bothers to see what this researcher has done on his study on job stress, on job satisfaction. Can't the findings of the researcher be applied in our industry? This doesn't happen because there is lack of industry academia coordination and cooperation. Although you approach a firm, collect data and carry out analysis, but the benefits of your research will not reach the firm about which you have done the research itself. So getting the degree is the ultimate goal of academic research, and as a result, it lacks practical utility value. So I will tell you more about it when I conclude my session. Then influence of government policies. See, government plays a major role influencing things that happen in our daily life. So what is valid today may not be valid tomorrow. What was lawful yesterday becomes unlawful today. So sale of cigarettes, smoking in public places is banned everywhere. And sale of liquor is banned in some of the states in India, although some states allow it. Certain laws have been amended by the government from time to time, or being amended by the government from time to time. There was a time we had many monopoly organizations. If you take insurance business, LIC had monopoly. If you take banking business, nationalized banks had monopoly. then railways have monopoly. They are the only monopoly organization still existing in India. In all other sectors, you have private players, insurance, banking, airlines. There was a time when Air India had monopoly, but with the entry of so many private airline companies, now that sector has become highly competitive. So there was a time when the MRTP Act was relevant, but the MRTP Act has been abolished in India, about which you all know, because we don't have any monopoly organizations except the railways. So the need for an MRTP Act doesn't exist now. It has been abolished, and in its place, the government has introduced the Competition Act. This is the Competition Act that replaces the MRTP Act. You all know why the Competition Act has been brought into force: to regulate competition among the various players in the market. So there are public companies, private companies, foreign companies, and each one should have equal opportunity, fair opportunity should be given to all the participants of the industry. So nobody should have any undue advantage over the rivals in the industry. So it is only to regulate competition, the Competition Act has been brought into force. So that act is relevant, and any research done earlier on MRTP has no relevance today, because the MRTP Act itself has been abolished. Similarly, in the past, we had several indirect taxes in the form of excise duty, entry tax, sales tax, luxury tax, entertainment tax, etc., etc. All these taxes have been abolished, and in the year 2017, the government brought out the GST, Goods and Services Tax Act. So it's only GST which is relevant today. So any reference to excise or sales tax has no relevance at all. There might have been research studies on sales tax provisions done by researchers in the past. All those studies have no relevance. They are considered redundant today. So it's the government policy, the policy decision of the government, which has brought about this change. So I have mentioned to you some of the peculiar problems a researcher in social science and in commerce would normally face as he goes about his research work. I have also highlighted in my presentation how is academic research different from business research. See, it's not that only we academicians do research for the sake of our MPhil or PhD degree. Every business does research throughout the year. They have what is called the R&D, Research and Development Department, that will conduct research throughout the year. Why does the business conduct research throughout the year? Because they want to bring out new concepts, new products, new services. And if there are problems with the existing products, they try to identify the problem, locate the problem, remove the defect, and make it good. It is for this reason R&D is conducting research throughout the year. Now, what is the difference between the research done by the R&D of a business and the research done by an academician? Business research is always result oriented, that we should remember. So the outcome of business research is a new product, a new service, or an improvement over an existing product or service. Some defect in the product has been identified and rectified. This is what is the outcome of any business research. But in so far as academic research is concerned, it is not the outcome, the findings of the researcher which get the focus. Nobody asks, what is it that you have found out? Utmost importance is given to the methodology part of the research only in academic research. So they see whether you have formulated the hypothesis correctly, whether you have selected the correct sample size, whether you have adopted the right method of sampling, whether you have done proper data collection, and whether you have used the proper statistical tools for analysis. It is only these technical details which get prominence in academic research, and you come out with certain suggestions and you end your study with certain conclusions which are not given utmost importance at all. But it is Not so in the case of business research. In business research, it is the outcome of the research alone which is important, not the methodology of research. How you have done the work is immaterial. What is it that you have done? What have you concluded? What is your solution to the problem? Have you come out with anything new? That's what the top management is interested in. They don't see how you have gone about the research work. But in academic research, we only see how the researcher has gone about his research work. Then, secondly, academic research is purely based on literature review, about which I mentioned to you already. So you review past studies, find out what is missing in those past studies and what is it that you can do. But in business research, it's not so important to review what has been done in the past. So they only see the actual problems that the business faces in its operations, and they try to find a solution to the problems that face their day-to-day business operations. Then the audience for the academic research is the general public. We all know that everyone participates in the public 5 hours examination of a PhD, public 5 hours examination. Anybody is allowed to attend. Yeah, that's why it is called the public 5 hours examination. But what about business research? Who is the audience for the business research? The reports of the R&D team will not be made available to the public. It's not a public document. It's kept confidential. It is shown only to the top management for them to evolve certain policy decisions. So unlike PhD thesis, which becomes a public document, in fact, the copy of the thesis is kept in the library. We are going to have a PhD 5 hours examination in our department next week also. The copy of the thesis has already reached me. It's there in my room. Anybody who wants to see the thesis can have access to it, go through, participate in the public 5 hours examination, and you can raise questions. But insofar as the R&D research is concerned, the research reports will be kept confidential and it will be shown only to the top management so that they can decide on what next. Then, that's what I have stated in the next sentence also. Anyone can access the thesis, which is the outcome of academic research. The details of the outcomes of business research are kept confidential. Then academic research is pursued with the objective of securing a research degree. But why do you do research in commerce? Why should a student get himself registered under a guide, do his PhD work over a period of 3 years? Because he wants to get a doctoral degree from the university. And that is what is the objective. But business research is undertaken with the objective of bringing about qualitative and quantitative improvements in the products and services that are produced and marketed. So R&D is not interested in getting any degree, it's going to get one from any university. So it will be based on bringing about qualitative and quantitative improvements in the products and services marketed and produced and marketed. Then academic research is funded by the researcher himself. For social science research, of course, you don't require much in terms of funds. Maybe science, those who do research in natural sciences, they may require more funds because they have to do a lot of lab work. But in social science, there is no lab work that is involved. And if necessary, you can also get stipends, fellowships and scholarships from funding agencies like the UGC or the CSIR, Council of Science and Industrial Research. But the funds needed by the R&D department of a company, of a business, will be provided by the top management itself. So they are self-sufficient. Funds will not be a constraint for the R&D staff. They get all the funds they require from the top management. The immediate beneficiary of the academic research is the researcher himself. Researcher first, who does it for the sake of securing a degree. Someone who wants to review his literature later in future, he can have access to his thesis and do that. That's all. Nobody else is benefited. But the beneficiaries of business research are first the company. the company gets the benefits of R&D first. Then whatever suggestions they introduce, it will be incorporated in the product or service. So the consumers are going to be benefited. And finally, the society at large will be benefited out of the research of R&D. Then business research will focus on finding a solution to your problem. So that means the R&D will have all the will have complete access to the records of the firm. But when an academic person approaches a firm, they will not give him access to all the records of the firm. Supposing you want to study the problem of job stress, you seek an appointment with a firm. As a research scholar, if you go there and ask for certain documents, they will not give. They may not even allow you to interact freely with certain categories of employees. At the most, you can interact with floor level workers only. They may not allow you to meet executives and ask them certain sensitive questions about their company. But as far as R&D people are concerned, they have full access to all the, because it's for the benefit of the company only they are doing the research. So they have complete access to all the records. They can ask any employee any questions. They have full permission from the top management. Then a team of R&D professionals will be constantly engaged in research, so they can update when necessary. Whereas in the case of academic research, we all know that once the thesis is submitted, VIVA's examination is held, degree is awarded, that's the end of it. There is no follow-up. And there is no scope to implement the suggestions of business research. There is scope to implement the suggestions made by the R&D. But in academic research, you can offer suggestions, but nobody will be interested in listening to your suggestions. So get the degree and be happy with it. That's all in academic research. Then some peculiar problems. Some of these I have already pointed out. With the passage of time, your findings in social science research will become irrelevant. Data for the study are collected from the respondents based on their values, beliefs, opinions that do not remain constant. 15 years back, if a study was done on retailers' services in the market, the respondents would have said many things favorable to retailers. But if a study is conducted today on the role of retailers, people will only criticize them, blame them for all that they do in the market. They are responsible for the higher price we pay for any product we buy. Whereas the online merchant gives us so much of benefit in the form of discount, free gifts, etc., etc., which are denied by the retailers all these years. So values, beliefs, opinions do not remain constant. So they change, and when they change, the findings of any research study also will become irrelevant. Then statistical analysis of qualitative data will pose problems for the researcher. I mentioned to you about it. I told you about scaling and all that. Then often convenient sampling is used by most of the researchers, which will affect the results. The results will never be accurate when you go for convenient sampling, because it's according to your convenience you choose the sample, not because it's required for the study. Then often the size of the sample is too low when compared with the size of the population. So obviously the results of the analysis will not be reliable. Then the effectiveness of primary data depends much on the capacity of the researcher. So not every researcher has same amount of capabilities. One is good, one is not so good. So the effectiveness of data you collect depends much upon how efficient you are in preparing the questionnaire and in collecting the data. And also it depends much on the capability of the respondent. Does he understand your question properly? Not every respondent is good in grasping the subject matter of the questionnaire. So he just puts a tick mark, and that is taken for face value by the researcher. That is how academic research is being done. Then in conclusion, I have given certain points here. What is the need of the hour? Industry, academia, coordination is what is required now. That's the need of the hour. See, we all do research, get our research degree, but what is the outcome of your research? Who is the beneficiary? So when you want to do a study, research study on job stress of IT firms, what is actually to be done is that there can be a tie-up between the firm and the researcher. So someone from the R&D or from someone from the HR department of the firm may join our research scholar who works for his PhD degree. So they may work as a team. They may, both of them may work under a research guide approved by the university. So they can go about doing the entire research work and come out with a thesis. And the thesis can be presented in any forum. And they should be able to defend it. They come out with certain solutions to the problem of job stress experienced by employees in general and IT employees in particular. So later, when the degree is awarded by the university, the suggestions offered by the research team should be capable of being implemented in the IT sector. That is important. Only then the practical, the utility value of our PhD degree will improve. Otherwise, if we are going to do the research in the manner it's being done now, obviously our research degree will not have any utility value at all, and it will continue to be what it is till now. With this, I conclude my session. Thank you very much. I think I spoke for almost 1 hour.
Yes, sir.
If you have any questions to ask, I'll be very happy to answer. Please.
Yes. Audience, if you want to ask any questions, you can please unmute yourself and ask the question, and please mute it again so that it may be easy for the resource person to convey the answer. So those who are interested can ask your question. You can mute your, means you can unmute yourself and you can ask the question.
Anybody?
Okay, so I'll start. Sir, I have a question.
Sir, yes. Akila here.
Yes, Akila, go ahead.
Nothing, sir. Nothing, no questions as such. Just thought I will share my feedback rather than any clarification.
Very good. Go
so
ahead.
So, like, you coined the session in such a way that researchers or to be researchers exactly the way they wanted, sir.
Thank
it
you
was like you were just, it was so simple the way you explained. You took us with us. We traveled with you. So, it was, I think, for researchers and to be researchers, definitely it will be a wonderful session to understand the basics and problems. So, thank you, sir. Thank you for the knowledge sharing and enhancement. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you
sir.
For your feedback, Akila. Thank
yes,
you.
Sir. Yes, sir. Students, you can use this opportunity. You can just clarify things with, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I have one doubt.
Yes. May you know who it is?
Ranganathan from First MCOM Day.
Yes, very good. Go ahead.
Sir, can we consider a comparative study between two products or two services as a research?
Yes, it is possible. Such research studies I have come across. You compare one brand with another. It has been done. It is possible.
Okay, sir. Sir, if we done, it is possible. Does it contribute to the industrial persons? Like, for example, if we consider Google Meet and Zoom, we are comparing the user satisfaction. If the results in favor of either it's for Google Meet or Zoom, it is useful to the concerned company?
See, the researcher is not biased, okay? So he has presented facts as they are. That is how it should be taken. So if it is in favor of one firm, doesn't mean the researcher endorses the product of that firm. It's not like that.
Yes.
Clear?
Yes, the question I want to ask is that if they are giving some feedback, like using Google Meet, we face some certain issues.
Okay.
Those are the areas that the company should improve. So,
yes, if only it is brought to the knowledge of the company. Does the company don't know that such and such research is being carried out? That's why I mentioned to you already that there has to be a tie-up between academic research and business research. The company concerned should know that such and such research is being done on Google Meet and Zoom Meet. Okay? The CEOs of both should know that such and such research study is being done. So when you offer suggestions to one, they'll be in a position to accept it and come out with the remedy.
Do they fund the companies? They fund these kind of.
As of now, we don't have any such provision. I am saying, if you really want to increase the utility value of academic research, see, research done by R&D is always good. It is beneficial to the company. But what about our PhD research? To whom it is beneficial? It benefits the researcher at the most. And to certain extent, it benefits the guide also, who proudly says, I have guided so many PhD scholars, so many MPhil scholars.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes. Welcome.
Anyone else? Students, anyone else have a question? Okay, if not, sir, I have a question to you, sir.
Yeah. Somebody asks. Who is it?
Sir, Niveda. Niveda, go Incom, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, one small doubt, sir. You have told about convenient sampling, sir.
Yes.
Which type of sampling could be the best, sir?
Stratified sampling is always better, because it gives weightage for each group. Stratum, we say stratum. Strata is plural form of stratum.
Yes, sir.
So if you are doing a study with reference to employees of Chennai, you divide Chennai into North Chennai, South Chennai, Central Chennai, so that each segment gets proper representation. But if you choose firms which are close to your place of living, that is convenient sampling, then the results will not be reliable. Equal representation should be given to all segments of the universe, population.
Yes.
Correct?
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Sir, if you can throw some light on what is a research gap, because that will be a very important point for the scholars, sir.
Yes. See, you identify some research problem. Let it be job satisfaction, labor turnover, brand preference, let it be any concept. The problem has been identified, but how are you going to go about your research work? What are the variables you will consider? So many variables influence a phenomenon. Labor turnover is the outcome of so many factors. Labor turnover is the employee leaving the job. He leaves for so many reasons. Maybe the salary package is not attractive. Although he has taken up the job, he is not happy with the monetary benefits. Or maybe the management is autocratic in nature. He doesn't get proper cooperation from fellow workers. So there are so many reasons that can be given as to why an employee resigns his job. But are you going to consider or think of all the factors affecting labor turnover? Will you be able to give focus to all the factors? Definitely, there are hundreds of factors which you can identify affecting any problem researched. So what you will do is, you go through earlier research studies and find out what has been done by earlier researchers. They would have highlighted certain factors in their studies. There should not be repetition. See, there is no point doing research on a problem, focusing on variables already considered earlier by other research scholars. So recently, in fact, some of my PhD scholars, who are, I'm sure some of them are with me now, I have told them clearly, somebody wanted to study internet banking. There have been studies on internet banking already. So I gave the suggestion, you do the study with reference to demonetization. Internet banking is there for more than 20 years. So there have been studies already. So if you can focus attention on demonetization, which motivates more people to go for online banking, that will be better. That is how the gap has to be identified. So if you do retail online marketing in the context of COVID-19, online marketing is there for so many years. Okay, there would have been research studies, but you don't come across many research studies on online marketing in the wake of the pandemic situation. This forces most of us to go for online marketing only. In fact, even food, there are food apps available, and we buy even hotel food through food apps only nowadays. because we were hesitant to go out some time back. So probably Swiggy and Zomato were the only options available to us. So it should always be related to current situations. So you may not come across many studies on a particular phenomenon, taking into account the current political, economic, and other conditions prevailing in the country and in the world at large. Okay? So this, I think, yes, if you do review of literature, that's what the review also will reveal. Because okay, review of past studies would have considered only the then prevailing conditions. They don't reflect variables that we talk about today. I hope it's clear, Vijay Narayan.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Because many people have this doubt when they start their research work, either for MPhil or for a PhD or for a commerce, like where we speak so much about research gap that they don't understand to get the actual meaning of research gap. I think now they would have got a better answer, sir.
In fact, I would always tell my research the second chapter in the thesis is always earmarked, yes, for literature review. So when you conclude, yes, your chapter on review of literature, you must say that I have reviewed so many studies and I have identified, yes, the gap. This is what is missing, yes, in all those, the missing part, the lacuna, we say. So what is missing, correct, in all those earlier studies, that is highlighted by me in my research work. My research would focus on the missing element. That is what is the research gap. That is how, in, yes, fact, you have to conclude your second chapter of the thesis. Research, correct, gap. That should be the concluding, yes, part of the chapter on literature review.
Correct, sir. Thank you, sir. So any other questions or
clarifications? Sir, I'm Shivam, sir, from MPhil, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Sir, I want to know what is the difference between a Gutmann rating scale and Thurston rating scale, sir? Or when we use such a rating scale, sir? In what type of data?
To be very frank with you, I am not familiar with all the scaling techniques used in research. But for academic research, it is only Likert scaling which is used. So I am only quite familiar with Likert scaling that gives 5 options to the respondents. You can refer any standard book on research methodology that has a chapter on scaling techniques itself. There you will, yes, come across so many scaling techniques suggested by so many experts. But the one that is used mostly in academic research studies is the Likert's 5-point scale.
Correct. So as Sar was saying, scaling itself is literally an ocean. If you want to have a session, probably we should have a separate session, yes, on scaling, because now today we have like Gutmann scaling, Thurston scaling, semantic differential. It is, yes, it is a huge topic to be discussed. Probably I think we will have a separate session
for that. Can be a session on that itself. There can be a session, yes, on scaling techniques itself.
Yes.
And there is no hard and fast rule as to the particular type of scale that you have to use for your study. You can use, yes, any scaling method you are comfortable with and suitable for the study.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, welcome.
Thank you, Shivam. Thank you. Thank you. Sir, can we wind up, sir?
Yes, we'll wind up.
Okay. So, thank you so much, sir. I was actually wondering, like, you were coming up with very peculiar problems, which actually, which is exclusively for our commerce and social sciences. And at the end, I was saying, you know, I was expecting some solution and you have given some possible solutions as a suggestion. So thank you, sir, to just have a formal vote of thanks. So it gives me an immense pleasure to propose vote of thanks. At the outset, first, I would like to thank our management of DGVC, especially our secretary, Sri Ashok Kumar Mundraji, and our beloved principal, Captain Dr. Santosh Babu, and our HOD, sir, Dr. Jayashankar, sir. And thank you so much, sir, for having faith on me and giving me this wonderful opportunity to organize it. And I also thank my colleagues at this point of time and Dr. Sundari ma'am, especially for having, you know, so cordially correlating. And last but not the least, all the audience who have patiently listened to him and who have raised the questions. I think this session would have definitely thrown a light on how to start a research, definitely, because this is just a starter session. He has rightly pointed out various peculiar problems, because I know as a researcher, when I started my career, we do not know the broader perspective of the research. I think this would have given a broader perspective of it, and probably we can proceed further. So thank you so much, all the audience, and thank you, HOD sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you all for your participation, for making this session interesting and a big success. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Please fill this feedback. Yeah, yes, ma'am.
Please share your feedback on the session. Dear participants, you all, please share your feedback on the presentation.
Okay, sir. Thank you so
shall
much.
Shall we wind
sir.
Up? Shall we leave Vijay Narayanan?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. We can leave, sir. We shall leave, sir. Thank you so much, sir.